Hello everyone, let us discuss about this week's topic, stroke. Stroke is basically of two types. It is either due to an infarct or due to a hemorrhage. Both the common cause majority of the time is the arterial. Only less than 1% is a venous cause. In infarct, let us see about the infarct. It is due to the anterior circulation disruption or a posterior circulation disruption. Majority is the anterior circulation. In that itself, the most common artery involved here is the middle cerebral artery when compared to the anterior cerebral artery, and which causes the total anterior circulation stroke, partial anterior circulation stroke and the lacuna stroke. In the posterior circulation disruption, the major artery is the posterior cerebral artery involved, which causes the posterior circulation stroke. Now, the etiology behind the whole of the infarct type of stroke is the either an emboli or a thrombi. Now, let us see the hemorrhagic type of stroke. It causes either intracerebral or a subarachnoid hemorrhage. Here, the basic etiology involved is the hypertension, and the other causes can be aneurysm, rupture of aneurysm, or an AV malformation, or a vascular degeneration. Less than 1% is a venous type of stroke. It occurs due to a secondary hemorrhage. It causes a central venous thrombosis. Now, let us see the pathology of the ischemic stroke. Basically, for any focal cerebral infarction, the pathology is of two types, necrotic or apoptotic. Apoptotic is a general programmed cell death, but here in the ischemic stroke, it causes a necrotic type of infarction because the ischemia causes a necrosis, which in turn lead to the depletion of ATP, and it causes the influx of calcium ion, and it depolarizes the neuron, which in turn releases the glutamate, and this glutamate is a neurotoxic, which lead to the manifestation of the ischemic stroke. See, this is the cascade of cerebral ischemia. The arterial occlusion, which causes the ischemia, leads to energy failure, and it causes the calcium sodium influx, which lead to proteolysis, cytoskeletal breakdown and cell death. Here the free radical mechanism is also involved. Mitochondrial damage is also involved. Now let us see the etiology. Here we can see the three arteries, anterior cerebral, middle cerebral and the posterior cerebral. Here the anterior cerebral artery supplies mainly the frontal lobe. The middle cerebral supplies the parietal lobe and the temporal lobe, as we can see in this figure. And the posterior cerebral artery supplies the occipital lobe. See, the basic cause of ischemic stroke is either a thrombi or emboli. The emboli is from a cardiac origin, or it can be a paradoxical emboli arising from a DVT, which crosses to a left side via either a patent foramen ovale or an atrial septal defect. The uncommon causes of ischemic stroke can be hypercoagulable disorders, vasculitis, venous sinus thrombosis, fibromuscular dysplasia. But here, the hypercoagulable disorders and vasculitis can also lead on to a hypertensive stroke. Now, let us talk about the important topic, penumbra. Penumbra is nothing but, it is an ischemic region which can be revived again after reperfusion. Our main goal for the ischemic stroke is to revive this penumbra. Now, we have to know another important term called as transient ischemic attack. Here, the transient ischemic attack is like a stroke event, but this event occurs briefly when compared to that of the stroke. Now, why we have to learn is that because when a person gets a transient ischemic attack means they have 20 to 30% chance of getting stroke their future. The risk for a stroke after this attack is based on the ABCD square score. A stands for age more than 60, B for a BP, C for a clinical symptoms like unilateral weakness or a speech disturbance, D for a duration, and D for a diabetes. Now, based on this score, they will tell about the risk of that person getting the stroke after this attack. Now, let us see the hemorrhagic type of stroke. The causes here is the any head trauma, or hypertensive hemorrhage, which is the most common cause, or any pre-ischemic infarction, or any tumor which causes the bleeding on itself, coagulopathy, drug, aneurysm, AV malformation Latin. Now let us see the clinical feature of stroke. First we have to look out for a general appearance and the consciousness of the patient. Then next the pulse, because the common cause for ischemic, as I have said, is an embolic which arises from the atrium, and it can also be due to the atrial fibrillation. So with respect to pulse, if it's an irregular means, we can think of an atrial fibrillation as a cause, because ischemic stroke, even though after we reperfuse, that is the primary treatment, but the secondary treatment is we have to remove the cause which causes the ischemic stroke. So we have to treat this atrial fibrillation. Next we have to control the BP and look for any mitral stenosis present or not. And then higher cerebral function, which tells us the involvement of area of the brain due to either ischemia or a hemorrhage. And then a cranial nerve function, it tells us which all cranial nerves are involved. If there is a dysphagia, dysarthria means the 9, 10, 11 cranial nerves are involved. And then we look out for a motor symptom, a hemiplegia, whether it is a unilateral or contralateral. Based on that, we can localize the symptom or site of the brain which is involved. Then the sensory system involvement, it can tell us whether the thalamus or the either a spinal cord is involved or not. And then we look for a gait and Romberg test. We with respect to that, we see whether the cerebellum is involved or not. Now let us move on to the general examination. Basically in skin, we look for xanthelasma, because if there is a high cholesterol means, there is an atherosclerosis process going on, which can cause either a thrombi or emboli, which lead on to a stroke. Xanthelasma is one of the clinical features which tells us about the whether the atherosclerosis is present or not. And then we look for any rash, color change, or any pressure injury. Then in eye, we look for arcus senilis. It tells us whether the patient is of any old age. Old age means they are more prone to a stroke features. And then diabetic retinopathy, hypertensive retinopathy, retinal emboli, like that. In cardiovascular system, we look for any atrial fibrillation is there or not, or we look for any prosthetic heart valve is placed or not, like that. In respiratory system, we see the features of pulmonary edema or infection and oxygen saturation. And then in locomotor system, we will look for the injury sustained with the stroke, whether there is a fall or any injury to the hip joint, like that. Now, for a rapid assessment of a suspected stroke, there is a scale called as a Rosier scale. It tells us about the probability of stroke in an acute presentation, because there are so many conditions which mimic stroke. So this score tells us whether this is actually the probability of stroke for this patient is more or not. And then we look for exclusion of hypoglycemia, which also causes a syncope and stroke-like presentation. And then we look for a language deficit, motor deficit, and sensory visual inattention like that. See, this is a test called as a clock drawing test. This tells us whether the patient has any Hemi-Nicolet syndrome or not. Hemi-Nicolet mainly tells us whether the parietal cortex is involved or not. See, in this side, the left side, totally the patient has not written anything. It tells us that he has completely neglected the left side and he has written only the timings of the clock in the right side, which is called as a hemineglect. It tells us the parietal cortex is involved in this patient. There is a score for hemorrhagic type of stroke, which is called as an ICH score. Based on the age, hematoma volume, intraventricular hemorrhage present or not, infratentorial origin of hemorrhage, and then based on the Glasgow coma scale, based on this point score, it tells us about the morbidity present in the intracranial hemorrhage type of stroke. For a clinical diagnosis of stroke, first of all you need to take CT, because CT tells us rules of, as the hemorrhagic type of stroke. In CT is the fastest mortality, so it helps us in faster treatment. In ischemic stroke, it also tells us whether the reperfusion therapy is the candidate is eligible or not, because if the stroke has happened for more than 6 hours means, then even though we give reperfusion therapy, the patient won't improve. So the CT gives us the extent of the involvement. See, if the patient is eligible means, we give the thrombolytic and mechanical thrombectomy. If he is not eligible means, we give an aspirin as a prophylaxis to prevent a further stroke. Now, how to manage any patient with an acute stroke? For any trauma or management, we have to look for airway breathing circulation, which is the most important part. Here also same. The airway breathing circulation is maintained, and then we additionally give hydration, nutrition, and then medication for dysphagia, and then we control the BP, blood glucose, we monitor the blood glucose, and here temperature. See, for basically the ischemic stroke, if the patient is pyrexic, means it leads to more morbidity. So we have to control the pyrexia and along with the treatment of the stroke. This is an important point to remember. And then we look for the management of incontinence, and we have to mobilize the patient. See, this is the basic layout for stroke management. Stroke, after doing a CT, we rule out hemorrhagic type, and then come on to ischemic. Ischemic, then we do a ECG. We look out for a cause of where the origin of thrombi or emboli is present. If there is a sinus rhythm, means we go for an antiplatelet drug. If it is an AFib, means we then do a thyroid function test and an echo. And then we do a cardioversion or an antiarrhythmic. And then we again go for an antiplatelet drug. And then after doing ECG, we have to do a carotid duplex. We look for a stenosis, degree of stenosis of the carotid artery. If the degree is more than 70, means we do a carotid endarterectomy. After that, we administer antiplatelet drug, mainly aspirin. And then we do other supportive measures like lowering of the cholesterol, lowering of the BP, and then lifestyle modification like smoking cessation, lower salt intake like that. So the summary, basically in stroke, what you have to remember means, first we have to see whether it is an ischemic type or a hemorrhagic type. We find out that by mainly doing a CT. In CT, if we find a hemorrhagic type, means it is a hemorrhagic type of stroke, and we manage it accordingly. And then if we find it is ischemic, means we first treat it by reperfusion therapy, and then find out the cause subsequently, whether it is a thrombi or an emboli, and then based on the origin, we treat accordingly. This is the basic concept of stroke. If you have any feedback, please share below. Thank you.